speaker, Victoria Jones, is with us courtesy of the support from Sunshine Coast Council, and we thank them for that. Victoria heads up Arts Health Associates, advising on arts health projects in Australia and around the world. She also leads Tea Projects, cultural consultants specialising in integrating creative programming and public art into complex built environments. Previously, Victoria founded multi-award-winning creative programs for Great Ormond Street Hospital, London, and the Royal Children's Hospital in Melbourne, and the Creative Communities Program for London Underground. Prior to these roles, she was the Community and Access Curator at Whitechapel Gallery. Victoria's presentation is titled, Where Do We Go From Here? How Do We Build a Meaningful and Innovative Arts Health Sector in Australia and Beyond? Welcome, Victoria.
Thank you, John. I'd just like to say thank you again, following last night. Thank you for inviting me. And yes, thank you, Marianne. I don't feel in any way qualified to follow up on what you've just said. So, yes, slightly different what I'm going to speak about today. John's asked me to come up and speak to everyone, and the task or the question given was, given my experience and lead involvement with programmes and initiatives in Australia and beyond, that it would be great to have my views and experiences with partnerships and approaches that I feel are necessary to build a meaningful and innovative arts health sector. So these are just my opinions, they're just the ramblings of a middle-aged woman. Feel free to disagree or agree. And thankfully, I didn't rely too much on slides. The slides I did put in just as like some pretty pictures. I have done a few things that I realised when I thought I should put this together. Just, I know yesterday I spoke quite a lot about, I really believe strongly that we need to connect with the arts sector more fully than we do. We do to some extent, but more fully. And when I started thinking about where I started from back in Whitechapel, which was an amazing place to work, you begin to realise how old you are. I think we should also recap on the value and the potential of creativity in health. I think, you know, just the speakers today and what we saw yesterday, there's a huge range of things going on and there's a huge number of impacts. But generally, it has been shown that using creativity in healthcare can reduce stress, it can reduce drug consumption, it can reduce recovery times, it can lead to shorter hospital stays, it has been shown to improve patient management, it improves the clinical outcomes, and it enhances the quality of the service provision. It has also been shown to improve job satisfaction and job retention. And generally, it improves healthcare experiences, not just for the patient, but for everybody involved. And there's a lot of different people involved in healthcare, beyond patients, doctors and nurses. There's a whole raft of people that affects. But the other thing that I think is really important, and I think there's an important shift coming, that we're actually beginning to see research that shows that creativity is good for our health. So you don't have to be unwell for it to benefit you. And actually, it's my belief that we need to focus on this and we need to have more creativity, more culture in our lives. As we've seen and from comments from the discussion last night, Western society and the Western ways of life has disconnected us from this. So I actually really believe we need to get back to that. And I personally don't feel the need to analyse it and have, you know, flowcharts and statistics to back it up, but there are people who do need that. And we need those. We need some of those statistics and some of that proof to help us, you know, push forward for progress and for that increased culture in life generally, but also within healthcare. So I think I mentioned this yesterday, so apologies to repeat myself, but there was an amazing survey, a nationwide survey done in Scotland, not that I'm biased, but it did show that people who attended a cultural place or event in the previous year were 60% more likely to report good health. So that's, you know, I think that's, if you take that, how can governments actually reduce arts funding, when, you know, when we can say that. And at a time when the UK, where the NHS is under huge health, funding crisis and, you know, political crisis, it's really important to remember some of these key facts. So going back to John's question about, you know, what's needed to build a meaningful and innovative arts sector, I think we have to think about where we are now. I'm never popular when I say this, but we are behind the UK. And I say that as a resident of Australia. I live here, this is my home. But unfortunately, we are behind the UK. Some people like to pretend we're not, but unfortunately we are. So I think we have to be honest. We have to look at where we are. We have to stop pretending that it's all fabulous. There's lots of fabulous things going on, but it's not as fabulous as it could be. There are some established programmes. There are some short-lived programmes that didn't last too long. There are startup programmes. We have a couple of umbrella organisations. But generally, I feel the sector has a low profile. It lacks recognition. And importantly, it lacks recognition from the arts sector, but it also lacks recognition within the health sector. It also lacks, seems to lack, recognition or support from the Arts Council, the Australia Council, and seems to have varied support from state to state arts councils. And then we have varying support as politics change within certain states. We have scattered activities, and I think generally we have a lack of unity in a disjointed sector. We also have a very large country, which is a huge challenge that I don't have the answers for. Oops. So I think it's a really important question to stop and think, where do we go from here? And where do we go from here? Where do we want to be? So where do we want to be? For me personally, I'm very ambitious, and I believe that basically art should be in every aspect of healthcare, from birth to death and everything in between, all stages of life. It's not just for children, it's not for old people. Well, it's not just for old people. We should have creativity on prescription that has been shown to you know, benefit a huge number of people. There should be art programmes in every single hospital. It should be something that's just taken as, you know, standard, and it should be expected. We should also aim to have government, Department of Health, regional and national arts council recognition and support throughout. In order to get to that blue sky daydream that I seem to have all the time, I think it's really important for us to identify all our stakeholders. Again, we know, it's not just about patients, it's not just about staff, it's not just about visitors, it's not actually just about the healthcare organisations. There's partners, and partnerships are hugely important. And it's about partner stakeholders, and actually, I think it's about everybody. I think everybody is the stakeholders, because nobody goes through life without having healthcare needs. Nobody goes throughout life without having creative needs. So our stakeholders are essentially everyone, which makes it a big job. The other thing we have to think about in this, you know, when I was putting this talk together, I was thinking in two different minds about individual programmes, and you know, I work with lots of different programmes and I help people take it from here to there as much as I can. But I also think we need to think collectively on the bigger picture, you know, where can we be? So a lot of what I'm saying today hopefully can be interpreted on, you know, smaller scale and larger scale. It's really important to know, when we say at the beginning, what's meaningful. So what's meaningful to, you know, a room full of people like we have today, where everyone's of a similar mindset? We will have some very shared, you know, goals and ambitions. But it's really important, and we touched on this last night, it's actually so important to understand your stakeholders, to speak their language. As Maz said, you need to have, you know, you need to be able to know what turns on a politician, what's going to change their mind, what is it, you know. Sometimes you need lots of PowerPoint, sometimes you need Excel sheets, sometimes you need a real life person. So different stakeholders have different values, and we need to be acutely aware of those values, because if we're not meeting our stakeholders' expectations and their ambitions, then we're going to fail and we're going to lose their support, and we'll be back singing on our own. Evaluation is critical, because we have to be able to prove that what we do isn't just nice. It's not just a nice thing, and we had a nice time. I hate the word nice. So we have to evaluate. We have to also, again, going back to the stakeholders' needs and wants in the languages they speak, we have to know what sort of evaluation and what sorts of things we need to measure for all those different people that are involved. Research is obviously part of that. But we also have to stop duplicating research. I read a lot of research papers, and I often see things and I think, oh, was that not already done? So let's stop wasting money doing things twice. Let's you know, share. If someone's done some research that you're interested in, then build on that, take that further. You know, go and work with that person, and it doesn't matter where they are in the world. You know, I've been working remotely on projects in Scandinavia. I used to live in Scandinavia, but during that time that I worked on that, I wasn't there. It was all done by Skype and email, so that can happen. And then also, you know, we have to report on what we, you know, what we do, what we find, and what we want to do. But I'll come back to that. We have to plan. So many times people talk to me and they say, "Oh, I'm doing this and I'm doing that, and what do you think?" And I say, "Well, okay, what's your strategy? Can I see your strategy?" Oh, we didn't really bother, we didn't have time, or that was quite boring and we didn't want to really do that. So I know strategy documents aren't fun to write, they're not, you know, it's not the most exciting part of anyone's day, but you need to do them. If you don't know how to do them, go and read some, get somebody to help you, call me, I'll help you. Because if we don't have a plan, it's a cheesy phrase, but if you fail to plan, you plan to fail. You need to have a plan. And again, going back to those stakeholders, especially with arts and health, you're going to be dealing with people who want to see a plan. They want to understand this. They want a step-by-step map. So how do we go forward? It's very important that we learn from things that went wrong. I think the arts is a sector where people don't like to talk about things that go wrong. People often, it's a dirty secret cover-up, don't talk about it, it didn't go wrong. Well, it does. Sometimes it goes wrong. We have, I think within arts and health, there's a couple of examples of umbrella organisations that went wrong. Way back in the beginning, when I started working in arts and health, there was the National Network for Arts and Health in London. It went spectacularly wrong, and I could tell you all sorts of things about why it did. There was infighting, there was lack of collaboration, there was funding issues, all sorts of things. Potential was amazing, but it just didn't happen. I don't know how much you keep up with these organisational things. I follow organisations. There was the Society for Healthcare of Arts Administrators, which then went to become the Society for Arts and Healthcare, then controversially decided to call itself the Global Alliance, and I think that was the death toll for them. They went south. They operated a fee membership model. There was infighting, there was funding issues, there was ethical issues apparently. They've now become the National Organisation for Arts and Health, which is a new thing coming out of the States. They're operating a fee membership model, which I have huge problems with. I don't think that works. We've seen that doesn't work. Sadly, the Arts Health Institute here in Australia just recently closed its doors, and as far as I've heard, it's all very closed zip-lip about what happened there. But I think we need to look at, you know, we need to look very closely at what happened with these organisations, understand it, and make sure that these, you know, problems aren't encountered again. You know, there are organisations, which I'll go to next, which are doing great things, and they can really help the sector, but we need to, you know, we need to be very honest about what doesn't work. I also, can I just say, I always bang on about this, so anyone who's heard me speaking has probably heard this before. We have to stop doing things for free, because in healthcare, there are no volunteer doctors, there are no volunteer surgeons, so why should the artists be expected to work for free? So, more positively, what is working? There's great things happening around the world. And I think the other thing I'd like to highlight that this is a global phenomenon, it's a global movement. So I think people, and I know this from personal experience, when you're developing projects or programs, there's times where you can feel very isolated. But there are amazing things. This is a global phenomenon. It's the awareness of the healthcare benefits for the use of creativity within healthcare, and the healthcare benefits just of creativity and culture, is growing across the world. So the Arts Health Network in Canada are amazing. Definitely check them out. In the UK, as I mentioned yesterday, huge developments being made for arts and health, even at a point where the NHS is going through terrible crisis and being attacked from the government, and all just disgusting. The London Arts Health Forum, again, is another example. So, there are really good things happening and happening in difficult circumstances. So, going back to John's question, when we think about approach, generally I believe that we need to be open, always open, transparent, collaborative, not competitive. I did say yesterday that competitiveness is healthy, but it doesn't mean that, we mustn't work against one another. A little while ago, I was asked to write an art strategy for the Olivia Newton-John Cancer Centre in Melbourne. And I've written God knows how many strategies, and so it's not something that I was unfamiliar with. But I thought, well, I'd actually like to see, do a comparison. So I contacted other hospitals, I won't name them, but I contacted other hospitals where I knew there was arts programmes. Some of them were newer than others, some were more established. And I was really horrified by the number of people, and these are people who know me, who turned around and said, "No, we're not going to give you that. That's private." Okay, is your hospital private? No. Okay, your hospital's public, and that's a public document. I didn't argue with them because I don't want to upset people. But if somebody contacts you and says, "Look, I'm doing this. Do you have something? I just want to look at it. Want to compare? What's the point?" What on earth is the point in saying no? I'm not going to plagiarise your work. I just want to see where it is. And if we have that attitude, then we are not going to get any better. We don't know what the benchmarks are. So share. And say, okay, well, I'll show you mine if you show me yours, if that's how you want to be, We have to stop being this kind of parochial, territorial. It's pointless. Really pointless. We also need to take part in relevant research, and my final thing is shouting and sharing. We have to shout about what we do and we have to share it. There's no point in keeping it quiet. If you value it and it's worthwhile and you're proud of it, then shout about it. Then to the next slide. My son made me put this one in. I said, right, I want a picture of a crowd. And we looked through Google and went, that one. I really believe in the power of, collective action. And as I said, Australia has quite a unique challenge of the size of the country. But technology is there now that we don't need to be disjointed. We can join together, God, the last 2 years I've worked in projects all over the world. I've worked, Skype, FaceTime, virtual reality, amazing. I don't think the size of this country, we can't use it as an excuse anymore. We can connect, and if we have a healthy attitude and we have this sharing and caring kind of attitude, sounds cheesy, but together we're stronger. You stand and sing on your own, that's nice, you might sound nice, but you're going to be louder and prouder when we all sing together. We need strategic leadership at all levels. We need to all be professional at all times. There's no place for rudeness. There's no place for ego. We need to respect one another. And sometimes that lacks. I've definitely seen that. We need to stop thinking about, are you from around here? Where are you from? Who do you think you are? Because that's not helping. We need to plan We need to collect and share, repeating myself again, but sharing is so important. And we need to build networks. I'm so amazed at everything I hear that comes out of Queensland. I think you have an amazing network here. Unfortunately, I can't say that it's the same where I live at the moment, down in Melbourne and Victoria. That, you know, if there is a network, I'm certainly being blacklisted because I haven't seen it. I do know people individually, but not collectively. We really need to think globally and not locally, and we need to build the profile. I know that Maz said yesterday that, you know, profile building alone is not enough, but when we have a health sector that doesn't realise and doesn't appreciate, some people do, some people definitely do, but we need to raise our profile within health. We need to have people understand what it is we do. It's not just some hippy-dippy nonsense. There's, you know, there's clinical research that backs up what we do and why. And we need to build a profile within the arts sector as well, because I think we suffer from bad reputation, you know, from that side. So I think that we need to raise awareness, and that, you know, until we have arts programmes in every hospital, in every healthcare, and we have arts on prescription, then we do need to raise awareness continually. We need to raise our game, grow the sector, improve our reputation. We need to develop and promote an evidence base continuously, and we need to celebrate best practice. I'm fed up going to conferences. Well, not this conference, another conference. There's another conference that sometimes doesn't have the best presentations, and I think that quality over volume should be a priority. So the power of partnerships, we touched on this a little bit yesterday. I have done partnerships with some big names. I do chase a big name, not for an ego point of view, but because I know that it brings people on board, and people go, ooh, ooh. And people who otherwise wouldn't look at what you do or wouldn't, you know, think it's any good. And there's a lot of potential in, you know, partnering with well-known organisations. But also, true partnerships work for both sides, and we must always remember this, we must be respectful of that, because I'm not sure if it's the same here really within the arts sector, but within the UK there's a big push for arts organisations to grow their audiences, and that's part of the funding that they receive. And actually what health offers is a whole new audience, so there's a whole section of people who otherwise wouldn't be, you know, interacting with those organisations. So that's, you're offering, and sometimes it's a captive audience, which is even better, they can't get away. So there's a whole, you know, it's a whole community of people that you can open up, you know, to music or theatre or ballet or whatever it is. But the other thing that's important about partnerships to me is that we connect to the outside. Healthcare can be very isolating. People, you know, feel very shut off. So it's bringing the inside, bringing the outside inside, but it also demystifies healthcare. A lot of people, I had a friend who was in hospital recently, and I saw my own husband kind of wince when we went to see him, because my husband's very scared of healthcare, and I see that, and that's natural. A lot of people have that, but we do need to demystify healthcare. We need to have people feel that, you know, that it's not this dreadful, horrible place to be scared of. With partnerships, as I said, we can get bigger impact, we can get more recognition, we can raise reputations, but we can also, very importantly, get twice the funding, because you've got match funding. As I say, successful partnerships should work well for both sides. So in order for that to happen, for that to be true, we need to take a lot of time to really, truly understand our partners' needs, ambitions, potential and limitations. And we also have to make sure that our partners understand our needs, ambitions, potentials and limitations too, because sometimes that work's not done, so that becomes a problem. The next thing I think that's important is to gain recognition and awards. A lot of people don't like awards, and they're by no means without issues. But gaining awards for projects or programmes is a really important way to show that you did something that was recognised, that it was compared to some other programmes, and it was a good thing. I've had various different awards. I won't bore you with that, but getting awards isn't good for me, but it's good for support for those things going forward. It helps people who, you know, aren't into what we do. It helps people, those people, to understand that it's a worthwhile thing. So definitely look to see what awards you can get. If there's healthcare awards in your area and they're not including arts and health, well, get nagging, get onto them and say, do you know? Because, you know, I think Vic Health has an arts health award. There's Building Better Healthcare Awards. There's the International Academy, which is an international award-giving body. So if places near to you are having healthcare awards and not including the arts, then definitely get on and nag them. Shouting and sharing, as I say, if you value it enough to do it, then value it enough to promote it. Don't accept, oh, we're not going to put you on the web pages. That's not acceptable. A couple of examples of global knowledge sharing platforms that you should look up is the Salus Global Knowledge Exchange. Now, this is an exchange that's mostly about building, but again, they are looking at arts and health. The RSPH in the UK has an amazing webinar series. You should definitely look at that. And there was the Culture, Health and Wellbeing International Conference in Bristol last year. All the sessions there are on YouTube, so that's a really good thing to have a look at as well. So just to finish up, it's amazing to have gatherings like this. I think the size of this gathering is particularly successful. It allows discussion and debate. I was also particularly pleased when John invited me and he showed me who he expected to come, because often when I come to events like this, it's everyone's an artist or everyone's a practitioner. There's no one from healthcare, there's no one from management. We need to start thinking about who we're talking to, because if we just talk to each other all the time, we're not converting anybody. So just to finish, I think we need to raise our standards, we need to raise our profile. This will increase understanding, which will increase recognition. With increased recognition, we increase demand. With increased demand, they will find the funding. Don't worry about that, that will happen, which will increase our activity, which all leads to positive progress. Thank you.